Hello, hello, everybody, and welcome to Coding with the Dead, Studio Remote, Coding with the Dead. My name is Moacir. I am the Research Data Librarian at Columbia University Libraries. I seem to be coming in a little bit hot, but now I think it'll be okay. And I am here to do some coding and stuff. So as you can see on today's schedule, boom, right over there, there's Illustrate, and make Wandertext more TypeScripty, which has been the remit for the past couple streams. I missed last week. This month has been crazy, but I don't like missing the stream because that is also time that I don't work on Wandertext. And the Illustrate is also a little bit of a problem with that because one of the things I'm working on is a course on for entering graduate students on research data management. And I am designing a whole lot of the graphical primitives for the animated sections. We're going to have a bunch of about 20 minutes worth of animated films. So this is the kind of stuff I've been working on like crazy for the last couple days. I could show a little bit of it just for laughs. I don't know if I'll actually be working on it, but you know, this is the sort of stuff that's been going on. So like you know, there's going to be a laptop in it, so I need to draw a laptop. And then what else? There's going to be a piece of paper. So let's hide the laptop. Oops. That goes here. Okay, so there's a laptop. So then there's a piece of paper. That's going to play a role. Then there's this Stonehenge-looking monolith of... Stonehenge-looking data center with monolith-looking servers that's inside a mountain that has a little top that drops closed. It's just, you know, I'm just goofing. There's a phone. It's over here on the side. What other stuff is there to show? Oh, all this stuff is going to be on a background, which looks like this. Where's the background? Here, there's like a table, and there's a part of a window, and there's some more of the whatever. You can kind of see this all coming together. And this will be one of the shots. There's only two real shots here. I should move this a little bit. There's only two real shots. This is one of them of sort of the objects that you saw earlier. So like here's a closed laptop. Here's the mountain. And the server. This is actually the first time I'm seeing these primitives on the actual background. And they look okay, I think. It's a piece of paper. Looks good, I think. And the opened up laptop, let's hide the paper. And, you know, looks like a laptop. And then where's the phone? Let's show the phone too. And then these are where the things are. This is the other shot, which has more of the, let me, I can zoom in on this. That has, you know, you can see the piece of paper and the phone. The mountain is actually over here because the way this is going to work is even though the mountain is centered here, let's hide the laptop, even though it's centered here, the camera will have panned over to this area, so it'll still be an overhead shot. It's going to look a little weird with the perspective, but like, you know, come on. We're not Pixar over here. So I'm still very excited how this all worked out, and I'm mostly excited because I'm done with the drawing part. I can put the stylus away, and I don't need to use it for the rest of this. This is for the first animation. There's going to be six or seven of them for about 20 minutes total, and I'm done with the stylus. So that's like huge for me, and you could see the various objects here. This is a bundle of index cards. That's how we are representing a data set, because the whole gambit of one of the ways that the course works is computers, anything digital is gone within the first minute of the 20 minutes. It's going to be talking about data in extremely analog terms because I feel that that will make it more approachable and give it more salience to graduate students across the disciplines. I haven't made the index cards yet for the overhead shot. The mountain we saw, here's the closed laptop. What other stuff do we have here? Oh, the open laptop. And then there's a puddle. The puddle is just it's a data lake. I haven't made the top version of that yet either. So I don't know. So there's a temptation to just keep working on this over the course of this stream. I don't, you know, but y'all are here for the embering, I guess. And the embering is what I should be doing. But, you know, this is one of the great things about my job is that I'm always doing different things. So the last 2 weeks, I've been spending a lot of time as an illustrator. And the next 2 weeks, it'll be a map expert because I have to prepare a lecture on, like a public lecture on cartography. So it's, you know, this is part of the fun of being a librarian is you get to be, you get to have your finger in all kinds of pies. But in any case, so that's where this all is. And I was probably working on this when I didn't have the stream last week because, like I said, I was super busy with stuff, and that's the way these things go. But let's do Ember, I think. I think that feels more appropriate. Excuse me. I think Illustrator is quitting, hopefully. I think this is the largest Illustrator file I've ever made, considering how long it's taking to save. I think it's because all of these textures are huge. I started cropping them and stuff, but... whoa, what just happened? Ah, I'm watching the show! Okay. Okay. So, let me hide everything except for the Wandertext stuff. So I forgot to mention this, the stream is now extra special, and like deserves extra, you know, like you can tell your friends that it's this like super cool thing because it's now no longer just being led by some rando librarian fellow, but it's now being led by an actual legitimate verified contributor to Ember Source. I put in my first pull request into main Ember over last week or 2 weeks ago, and it got accepted. I think, nope, it's not this one. Nope, these are... Okay, so let's just do... I don't know what this is going to do. Is PR. There we go. So, see? Merged into Ember.js master. I'm special. So the what I did effectively was Ember was doing this cool thing or peculiar thing. So I can go into a little bit of detail on this because I'm now like something like almost even an expert on this. So the way Ember works, if I do something like so here I am in Wandertext and ooh, this won't work in Wandertext. So, I thought I had like something like a dummy Ember. Okay, let's just go in here and we'll see how this works. So in here, if I do a... No, let's go into regular Ember. Okay, so here we have, in regular Ember, if I do like Ember generate component, foo. So, okay, so blah, blah, blah. And you can see that it isn't making thing. What is going on here? That's wild. Classic style components. Okay, so created add-on components foo.js. That's fine because this is all fake anyway. But if we go here and we look at this file, well, let's actually edit it. If we look at how it was made, This is kind of silly that I'm being confused like this. I think it's like this. Okay, let's see if now it does it correctly. Opa, okay, this is gonna take too long. Stop. Okay, rats, I thought I had a rather newish dummy Ember app. I probably don't. What's a dummy? Ah, okay. That is a dummy Ember app. So let's try this here. Ember component foo. Shoot. It's not making the component class. What happened? All right, I'm doing something wrong here with how I'm invoking the component class thing. Remember when I said I was kind of an expert now? So, all right. So we see here that we get a file that's three lines long. The first line is, let me make this a little bit larger. So it's import component from Glimmer component and export default class foo component extends component. And what's curious is that these two brackets are together here. Now, if you look at regular Ember, so in regular Ember, there's a blueprint for a component class, files, root path, name.js. So it has this thing that does like default export, etc. And that's how it knows how to build this file. And if you look at the tests, so this is in node tests, component fixtures, component, regular component, component.js. Okay, if you look, so this is the pre what I was doing for node, or for the pull request. If you look at the fixture has, it's a four line file because the brackets are not on the same line here, or the braces actually. So you have one brace here and you have one brace here. So this is kind of interesting because when you test the blueprints, so the templates that Ember CLI uses to build whenever you do like Ember G component class, if you run the tests on that, Ember CLI creates a file that looks like this, and then Ember tests to make sure that when you do Ember G component class foo, that you get this file. But as I showed you just now, when I did it on my own, I got them on the same line. And the what's happening here is that Ember CLI creates the file and then formats it. It does like speaking non-specifically, it lints it. I mean, it doesn't actually lint it. It just applies a formatting rule, and the formatting rule is that the braces are on the same line when they're blank and they're touching. There's no space in between them either. So this struck me as very odd because Ember has all of its code formatted with Prettier. And that's Prettier that's doing this. Prettier has a bunch of opinionated rules about how text should look. And one of the rules is like, you know, braces, if there's nothing between them, they shouldn't be on different lines. They should be touching. But Ember, despite the fact that its files are all formatted in Prettier, the actual fixtures of the blueprints and the blueprints are not formatted by Prettier. So it's just this sort of like Wild West of any old format goes, because the idea is that somehow Ember CLI when it's creating the files as a last step, it formats them. So even though in the testing, it relies on this, in the real world, you never get this file because it will already format it and fix up the braces before it even gets to into your repository. So that drove me a little bit batty because that's, you know, sometimes my more detail-oriented self gets a little bit itchy about these kinds of things, and this was that time because this was causing me a lot of trouble as I'm trying to update the blueprints for TypeScript in Ember. Because what I'm doing for that, or what I have done for that, is I just took all of Ember's blueprints, copied them, and converted them all to TypeScript. Or, you know, like, it's more complicated than that, but that's basically what I did. And I was having this problem where the files kept being reformatted, and like they would be out of sync with each other, because like the blueprint would be formatted but the fixture wouldn't be, so that there was always like spaces missing. And the braces are one example, but if you actually look at the commits here, you see that the main difference was that Prettier, I don't know if this is a new rule, now wants a space in between the function keyword and the parentheses for parameters when you have an anonymous function. So usually I would never be writing this sort of stuff because I would be writing arrow functions because it's 2022. But in the test environment, you need to, like, the you need the sort of how do you call it? The this has to be redefined or whatever. You know, if this were an arrow function, then the this would be it would be carried in from the calling scope, or, you know, whatever that language is. And then instead here, this way you get this in here. So and then you get this test doesn't show any examples of this, but I'm sure that there will be eventually some examples of this. Where did the this? So like this set my property, like where, you know, what is this? Well, this is the scope inside of this anonymous function that is the callback for the it tester. Anyway, so in the test, you always have this function space because you can't use arrow functions. So this is like, you know, you have to set up ESLint in a specific way so that it knows not to be like, hey, you should be using an arrow function here. But it's only in the test. So anyway, like the big change here is just adding this little space after the word function and before the parentheses, all in like, you know, in 138 files, basically. And then there are other things like adding a couple trailing commas when you have a list of properties, moving those braces together, a couple other little things. So you can see, this is adding a trailing comma. Here's another trailing comma being added. So this is setup component test, takes a path name, as the first argument. And then the second argument is an object with a it says whether the, if it's an integration test or a unit test, basically. Okay, so that's what I did, is I went through these 138 files and, like, you know, went piece by piece to make sure that they all were formatted okay in Prettier. And then that was that, and that got accepted into Ember Source. And now I feel super special. And now if you're watching this stream and today or in the future, I'm no longer merely Moacir Peter Sapereira Research Data Librarian, but I'm now Moacir Peter Sapereira Research Data Librarian and Ember Source Contributor. So actually, This may not be a bad idea. I can do it. I'll do a pull request on the fly because I noticed something teeny, but again, this is the sort of thing that if you know me, you know that I will get a little bit glitchy about. So Nullvox Populi tweeted something about, so here we go. So this is passing multiple blocks. So this is a part of Glimmer component that I'm still having problems like completely understanding how you pass these kinds of blocks and like what exactly the use cases are. There, I read this page and I read this documentation and I understand everything that's going on here, but I'm not sure when I would implement it myself. This is like in college when I had to stop taking math classes because I reached a point where if you showed me the answers to the homework, I was like, oh yeah, that makes perfect sense. But if you sat me down to come up with the answers on my own, I was just like, yeah, no, that's not going to happen. So, okay. So passing parameters, et cetera, et cetera. So there are some typos here. So, so this is in the API documentation. So if you were to edit this, where would you go to edit it? So does it say here something like edit? Nope. Okay, so let's figure this out. So I think this will be in EmberLearn. So this is the ember.com website. Maybe this stuff is in data. Nope. Let's look for something here that's likely to be only in this file. Documentation for template only. Yeah. Nope. Okay, so let's try in the whole organization. Nope. So let's try all of GitHub. I like this Glimmer component docs.ts. Okay, so I don't know why this is, this feels right. So let's go to emberjs.ember.js, and that was in packages, ember, internals. Was it? Ember internals glimmer. Okay. Glimmer. Lib. Components. Glimmer component docs. Okay, so there was a place where component was misspelled. So this is all in Ember.js, so that means that I can go to, so let's do this just for laughs. Let's do some pull requesting on the fly. So let me okay, I don't know how to do this using the command line. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a new remote called upstream, and it is Ember.js. And it's called Upstream. Oh, these are all fixed up because they are, so it says here that I have to push things. So your branch is ahead of origin master by 47 commits. So that's my version of master. So if I do git push origin master, this will push it to my version of Ember. So now I'm all lined up. I pulled down the latest stuff from Ember, and let's create a new branch. Glimmer component docs. And then let's see if I can remember where it is. Packages, Ember. Is it squiggly Ember? Yes. Internals, Glimmer, lib, component, components. Nope, it was component. Where did the documentation go? Glimmer component docs. There we go. Okay, so there was a typo, like I said. I think component was misspelled in one. This may be the exactly wrong way to do this. There it is. Nope. Component. I think it's like comop. There it is. Comop. We would generate ab comopnets. And it's just in that one place. And then I think the other problem is there's an its where it should be in ITS. Subclass to customize its, assigns itself, defines its behavior, customize its behavior. Up, this is already stuff that I know. So now let's look to see if it's like this. Nope. Okay, let's look for every apostrophe. None found. Let's look for every single quote. Which are the default components for Ember Octane and more recent additions. Signature, that's all right. That's all right. That's all right. This is code. Why were there double quotes? Oh, image source. Okay, so this is all in templates. Okay. So yeah, so just these two changes, two typos. That's it. And then let's open up a new tab and let's go to Wandertext because we're going to be working on that next. Because what I'm going to do now is I have to go here and now do I need to do yarn tests. Oops, I should probably do yarn install in case there are new versions of things. And then run the tests. Okie dokie. So now here we are back in Wandertext. It's, oh man, it's only 3:30. Wow, I thought I'd been wasting everyone's time with all this stuff, but I've been rather efficient. Okay, so I was here before the stream began to see where I was because it's been 2 weeks since I've done the stream. So I can see that, okay, I renamed some files to TypeScript versions. Did I actually make them TypeScript? Looks right. We'll ignore the part where it says this is completely wrong. This looks like TypeScript. Okay, while these tests are running and before I dive in too deep, I think I'm going to take a brief little break. So, oh, that involves typing here first. So, it's, what now, 3:37, so let's say 4:50, and, oh, 3:50, and the sun is right in my face. So I'll do this, and then I'll be back in about 15 minutes. See you soon. Thank you. Okay, I'm back. I have been given word from above that I should actually be doing some illustrating for the rest of the stream because we really should have these assets in the can, or however you want to put it, by EOD, end of business, today, 5 o'clock, so in the next hour. I am also... I'm still coming in so hot. I am also at that point in my life where we finally, and I haven't been trying to make this happen, it's just, or trying not to make this happen, but today's show from February 15th, 1973, will feature the first in the, so it's been over a year of Coding with the Dead. And we have yet to have a show that features the song that will kick in about 10 minutes. So I am going to take the rather non-standard step of killing my mic, firing up Adobe Illustrator, and just rocking out. So I'll still have an eye on chat, etc., if you want to say anything. But that's basically what's going to be going on for the next 40 minutes or so, is just rocking out. So enjoy the beats, and I'm going to kill my mic. I forgot. I have to finish this pull request, so let's do that. So during break, the tests ran and they all passed, so everything is great. So I can go ahead and push this to my... Oh, did I commit it already? No. So Ember has these kinds of rules for how commit messages look. So I'm just going to remind myself. Contributing. Standard issue labels. Nope, that's issues. Requesting a feature. Building. How to run unit tests. Pull requests. Add a test for it. Make sure to check out the JavaScript. Commit your changes. Please use an appropriate commit prefix. Doc. I like this. If I go up here, compare and pull request, look at this commit just to make sure. Yep, imported from which are the default components. Okay, this is awkward English, all told. That shouldn't be which, it should be because it's not. Well, whatever. An app comopnets. Components. Okay. Okay, so now here comes sunshine. Jeremiah is logged into the chat and says, "What's up?" I say hello back. And now this pull request, I'm doing live pull requests to Ember source. I mean, yes, it's fixing two typos in the documentation, but every contribution helps in open source. And so that's that. And now I will turn the mic off and do some illustrating. So let's do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Fade. Shake.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. It's 5 o'clock. I am not quite done with the illustration, but you can see sort of what's going on here. I really want this stack of index cards. That's what it's supposed to be, to really glow. I didn't really like how the outer glow filter is a little bit too limiting. So now I'm just making this goofy gradient with all these little things to sort of, you know, this is going to be cheating this sort of stuff in, and I'm going to be moving these lines around to sort of, you could kind of see how, whoops. You can sort of see how the glow is establishing itself. Come on, move. Move, there we go. And it really wants me to do curved lines, and that's fine, that makes sense. But I don't want to make curved lines. I want to just move these points around. See, like that's a little bit, but I can increase the spread. No, I can't because this is lines. So kind of just like move these around. And then this will have the effect of sort of, so these outer bands are kind of reining in the glowing. So I need to create another line here. So as you can see, all I'm doing is I'm making a gradient from white to white, but it has the opacity changes. So all these dots out here in the hinterlands are all zero opacity. So they kind of, but so this is what I don't like, is that you can kind of see that these are two points. So I should actually add a point here and a point here to sort of artificially create a straighter line here. And then I should do the same thing here, create an artificial line there. So now it sort of glows with like a rectangle. The bow doesn't look quite right. Maybe this has to chill a little bit. This may be a little bit unsolvable, or maybe that looks good. And so if I don't know if I can just change these colors. Break. Yep, it broke it. So I will need to change all of these whites to the appropriate color that I actually do want here. So this worked, like this helped having this sort of cheat this in, and I guess I can put another dot. Oops. Let me make a stop. I can sort of put a little bit of cheating in here. Maybe a little line here, actually. Yeah, that looks more like what I want here. So let's cheat this in a little bit. So it's the goal here is to give a kind of even blur gradient. So there should be one here too. Another little pressure guy pushing in to sort of give the humpness of the bow. Excellent. And then that means I can don't make a line here. That means I can move this up a little bit. It's a little bit too much. That looks good. Okay, so you can kind of see how it's making these kinds of fences here to sort of rein in the gradient. And man, learning about these kinds of complex gradients was one of the things I learned last week in preparing to make these illustrations. And wow, have I been having fun with them. I mean, maybe this looks tacky. I don't know. Maybe I don't care. But I should change all of these to a new swatch. Let's make a new global color. Let's just, I don't want to lose that gradient. So let's just click over here. Let's make a new color. Let's call this gold, because I don't know how I'm going to make gold yet, because I don't have a lot of experience trying to make things look golden. But we'll make a swatch and we'll call it gold, and we'll make it global. So now I'm going to bring it in here into this is all the swatches in this project. Excuse me. Let me not put it next to the official yellow. So in putting it here, now I can go back to the gradient. Look at all this extra content you're getting here. I can go back to the gradient here, and where is it? Let's call this glow. And I can edit the gradient, and then I can do... No, this is broken. It's doing the wrong thing. Escape, escape, escape. Deselect everything. Okay, so I can go to glow. Just select glow. Okay, that was the problem, is I selected everything. Okay, and now the glow, open up the gradient editor and edit the gradient. Okay, so now what I can do is I can click on all these points that are white and change them to... swatches? Yes! Excellent. Okay, so this... swatches? Excellent. This is exactly the behavior I was hoping for. So it's a little bit clumsy still because I have to go with... I have to escape out because it keeps wanting to make new lines. That's okay. This is, of course, how you create way more complicated... like, these can be any color. I'm just giving them a uniform color because I kind of want it to look like it's gold. Like there's a golden glow to it. Because it's supposed to get you super excited about data management. And then let's make this gold. And make this gold. Okay, so now some of the issues with the glow are becoming apparent, which is, you know, namely that the opacity is a bit too in your face. So that's not a problem, but instead of changing all these points again, what I will do is I will just do a global opacity. Let's switch it to multiply. Oh no, that's not going to work. Let's switch it to screen. And then dial it down. There we go. Yeah. Okay. So now, in completing this, there we go. We have a glowing set of index cards. And then what we have here is, okay, so let's look at it in context of the whole shot. So let's turn on the window, walls, shrubs, outside. And yeah, I think the ribbon doesn't really look like a gold elastic like I was hoping it would, but that's something I can figure out later. The important thing here, thanks, Paul. Yeah, this is all about thinking out loud because I, you know, otherwise it couldn't be done. I'm speaking out loud because I'm on camera, but yeah, this is figuring out this process. Figuring out how to make these look more like gold elastics like you get on a candy box, I'll worry about later. But this is extremely close to shipping, which means I have a phone, I have the index cards, I have a piece of paper which doesn't need to glow, I have a closed laptop, I have the mountain which I moved over here, and the mountain is encasing the holy Stonehenge server mountain. And then there's a laptop over here, and then there's a puddle across here. So if you can see that this is the end of the shot, but this stuff goes outside of the shot because, you know, whatever, I was not really sure how I was going to crop the shot, and this is unused. Okay, so that's all of the deliverables I need. Index cards, got it. Sheet of paper, got it. Notebook, I won't need. Closed laptop, got it. Mountain, got it. Servers, got it. Calipers, won't need. Spill, got it. Open, closed notebook, got it. Okay, so I think there's one last thing, but I'll stop the stream because it's a teeny tiny little thing, and then I can ship. So, Jeremiah, if you're still watching, that's it. We're finally going to ship these images. Otherwise... Thanks for logging in. You've seen the sun go down, so it went across my face. Now it's coming down below my face. And finally, it won't be in my face anymore. But I'll see you next week when I swear, we'll be doing more Ember, because these assets will have all shipped to the animators, and they will be making our little...